everybody.
Good evening.
It's good to see you a week later. It was just too darn cold last week. How about that? I think tomorrow it's like the 1st of July. That's what I heard. But, it's really good to see you all here. Would you, you guys bow your heads and pray with me before we get started? Father, we thank you to come for the opportunity to come together and celebrate the coming of your Son. We thank you that we can celebrate it a week later, and it still has the same impact that it did last week. We can celebrate it year long, and we can praise you, we can worship you. You are good, always. So again, we thank you, we praise you, in Jesus' name. So thanks again for coming. This is just gonna be an evening of celebration. We have various expressions of celebration and worship from various members of the congregation, and we're really excited to celebrate with you.
Thank you.
it seems like every story bringing good news has to reckon with bad news first. Our story is like that as well. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth, and it was good. God created human beings in his image, and that was very good. He placed us in a garden to cultivate and enjoy, a place of joy, of peace, of God's presence. But then, we believed a lie, and that lie caused us to doubt God's goodness. We sought to attain something we thought was good, something that would lead to knowledge and life, that in reality brought death. It brought alienation from the good God who made us and the home he prepared. The Bible describes it this way. When the woman saw the fruit of the tree was good for food and pleasing to the eye, and also desirable for gaining wisdom, she took some and ate it. She also gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate it. Then the eyes of both of them were opened, and they realized they were naked. So they sewed fig leaves together and made coverings for themselves. Then the man and his wife heard the sound of the Lord God as he was walking in the garden in the cool of the day. They hid from the Lord God among the trees of the garden. But the Lord God called to the man, "Where are you?" He answered, "I heard you in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, so I hid." And he said, "Who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree that I commanded you not to eat from?" The man said, "The woman you put here with me, she gave me some of the fruit of the tree, and I ate it." Then the Lord God said to the woman, "What is this you have done?" The woman said, "The serpent deceived me, and I ate." So the Lord God said to the serpent, "Because you have done this, cursed are you above all livestock and all wild animals. You will crawl on your belly, and you will eat dust all the days of your life. And I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between her offspring, your offspring, and hers. He will crush your head, and you will strike his heel." To the woman he said, "I will make your pains in childbearing very severe. With painful labor you will give birth to children. Your desire will be for your husband, and he will rule over you." To Adam he said, "Because you listened to your wife and ate fruit from the tree about which I commanded you, you must not eat from it, cursed is the ground because of you. Through painful toil you will eat food from it all the days of your life. It will produce thorns and thistles for you, and you will eat the plants of the field. By the sweat of your brow you will eat your food until you return to the ground, since from it you were taken. For dust you are, and to dust you will return." Adam named his wife Eve because she would become the mother of all living. The Lord God made garments of skin for Adam and his wife and clothed them. And the Lord God said, "The man has now become like one of us, knowing good and evil. He must not be allowed to reach out his hand and take also from the tree of life and eat and live forever." So the Lord God banished him from the Garden of Eden to work the ground from which he had been taken. After he drove the man out, he placed on the east side of the Garden of Eden cherubim and a flaming sword flashing back and forth to guard the way to the tree of life.
From your pew, turn with me to page 129. Yes, 129. O come, O come, Emmanuel. We'll do verses 1, 2, and 3.
Thank you.
I expected Jesus, and we will sing both verses.
Send the people he loved away without a fight. He planned redemption right from the beginning. He promised a savior. The child of the woman would crush the head of the serpent. The deceiver who led us astray and co-opted us into his rebellion would be defeated. And the promised savior would be both the child of the woman and the Son of Man. And he will be our peace. The Bible describes it this way. And I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and hers. He will crush your head, and you will strike his heel. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of deep darkness, a light has dawned. For as in the day of Midian's defeat, you have shattered the yoke that burdens them, the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor. Every warrior's boot used in battle and every garment rolled in blood will be destined for burning, will be fuel for the fire. For to us, a child is born. To us, a son is given. And the government will be on his shoulders. And he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the greatness of his government and peace, there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this.
Alrighty, if you would please take your hymnals and turn to 155. While shepherds watch their flock, we'll do verses 1 through 5.
Oh,
142. 142. All five verses.
The child that you carry is gone.
Pursued his people. He made covenants with them. He led them and spoke to them through the prophets, up until the last words of the prophet Malachi. And then, silence for 400 years. During this time, emperors and armies bent on conquest trampled and oppressed God's people. They cried out to him in anguish, and still, silence. Where was the God of promises? Where was the God who had delivered them before? Had he forgotten them? The answer came in a baby's cry. Let's listen to how the Bible describes this. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger because there was no guest room available for them. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Don't be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths, lying in a manger." Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those on whom his favor rests." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning that light, so that through him all might believe. He himself was not the light. He came only as a witness to the light. The true light that gives light to everyone was coming into the world. He was in the world, though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision or a husband's will, but born of God. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son who came from the Father, full of grace and truth.
Please turn in your hymnals again to page 137. We will sing all four verses and watch me at the end.
Thank you.
good news. In that baby boy, heralded by angels, God was entering into our world, keeping his promises, coming to save, bringing good news. Where we could do nothing to redeem ourselves and regain what was lost, God made a way and sent good news. He kept his promises. He broke the silence. The Bible says, "As for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sin, in which you used to live when you followed the ways of this world and of the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. All of us also lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our flesh and following its desires and thoughts. Like the rest, we were by nature deserving of wrath. But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved, and God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming ages he might show the incomparable riches of his grace expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith. And this not from yourselves. It is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do."
How exciting that is. Let us please turn to number 147, Joy to the World, all four verses.
Thank you. was come divinity incarnate, creator of the world, breathing out air. Behold what light has come, and the dark cannot contain it. The Savior of the world is finally here. Oh, come, let us adore Him. Come, let us adore Him. For He alone is worthy.
Comes with an invitation to experience it. Are you thirsty? Are you weighed down with burdens? God says, come. He has said it so many times and in so many ways, but let's listen to what He says here. Come, all of you who are thirsty, come to the waters. And you who have no money, come, buy and eat. Come, buy wine and milk without money, without cost. Why spend money on what is not bread, and your labor on what does not satisfy? Listen to me, and eat what is good, and you will delight in the richest affair. Come to me, all of you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you, and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart. And you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. The invitation is gloriously simple and open to all. Come.
We do come together tonight to celebrate. We'll light candles together to celebrate the light of the world coming. We light candles to signify that Jesus is the light. He says in the book of John about himself, he says, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. Jesus went on to heal blind men. And he said, when I am in the world, I am the light of the world. I want to invite the choir to come. And we're going to try to remain in our pews this year. I'll light my candle and spread it out to the choir. And one of them will make their way down to you. And you can light your neighbor's candle until all the candles are lit. But before we do that, let's pray. Father, again, we thank you for the opportunity to come together to celebrate you, to celebrate your Son, to celebrate our Savior, the light of the world. We thank you that we can trust and know that no matter the darkness that we face, you will light our way. You are our light and our strength. We thank you and praise you in Jesus' name.
Thank you.
Jesus also said, we as his disciples should be the light. So let us go and let us spread light around the world. Merry Christmas. Thank you for coming. Would you pray with me one more time? Father, we trust that you are our light. We thank you that through you, we can go spend our lives being your light, spreading the light around the world. Being the bridge between you and those who don't know you, who are living in darkness. And again, thank you for being our light, and that no matter what darkness we face, you're there. You are the light. We love you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.